Do you see what I see? Do you see what I see? I see lightning, I hear thunder. Something's stirring 6 feet under. Dead things coming back to life again. I believe there's about to be another resurrection. Oh, I see signs and I see wonder. I see persevering color. Dead things coming back to life again. I believe there's about to be another resurrection. Oh, come alive. Wake up, sleep. Oh, hallelujah, it is finished. See the grave, nobody in it. Dead things coming back to life again. I believe there's about to be another resurrection. Resurrection, oh. Come alive. You see what I see, that the grave is empty, and you know what I know, anything is possible. Do you see what I see, that the grave is empty, and you know what I know, anything is possible. Do you see what I see? Do you see what I see? Do you see what I see? Oh, I see signs and I see wonders.
Do you see what I see?
I see lightning, I hear thunder.
Do you see what I see?
Oh, something stirring 6 feet under. Come alive.
Thank you. Passion. You guys can have a seat. We're so glad you're here. It's been amazing weather, hasn't it? We're so thankful for it. Let's give it up for our band one more time. They put in a lot of time, but also, too, everybody turn around and look at the sound booth, because those guys back there do a lot, too. They run all the video, all the sound, all the music. It's just a ton of work, and I think sometimes they go without being said, but thank you to them as well. So we're thankful for them. Thank you for being here. You guys all got a connection card when you came in. It's exactly what it's called. It's a connection card. It's a way for us to be connected with you and you to be connected with Passion. So fill out that information on there. If you're a first-time guest, there is a gift for you back at that table along with some great Passion swag back there. So make sure you turn that in and you get a free gift if you are a first-time guest with us. Also, coming up, July 4th is almost here, which is super exciting. Family, Fun Fest, and Fishing Derby. Raise your hand if you like to fish. All right, I got a few. I got a few with two hands up as well. Well, anyway, bring yourself and your fishing pole out and invite a friend. Once again, I'm just excited to be a part of Passion because this is a way to maybe bring people that normally don't want to come to church. Maybe it's intimidating to be here on a Sunday morning, but it's amazing if you just want to invite them and say, hey, bring your pole and we're going to go out and do a fishing derby. It's just a fun way to get them plugged in here and let them know what the love of Jesus looks like, and it doesn't have to be overwhelming for them. So I'm excited to be a part of this Passion family where we can provide those things. So that day, July 4th, from 3 to 9. We are going to have some food. You guys need to also bring a side dish as well. Bounce houses and obstacle courses setting up over by the swimming pool over there. So, of course, bring your swimsuit for that. And then at dusk, having fireworks. So it's super exciting. Definitely a reason to invite your friends and family. There is a sign-up sheet for the fishing derby. So make sure you sign up at that back table to make sure you get in on that. Lastly, thank you for your continued giving. It goes without saying that is why we have so many things here. Please see giving and tithing as an opportunity to further God's kingdom. It's why we're able to provide so many things throughout this campus. And I just can't say it enough that if you want to know why we give or what's being done with those funds, please come ask someone, because we want to show you that it's going to further God's kingdom, because it's so important that what we do here is just a stepping stone to make sure we all get to spend eternity with Jesus together. So one more time, if you have any questions about the fishing derby, please see Molly or Darren. They're going to have all those questions answered for you, and invite a friend. If you guys want to go ahead and stand back up, we're going to get ready to worship again, but first let's just say a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this campus. Thank you for every single little blade of grass that you've provided here, Lord. We know that you knew who would walk on these grounds and who would need to hear about you. Lord, we're thankful for the opportunity to use everything to further your kingdom. And it's not about Passion, but it's about eternity that we're to be spending with you. And we want to invite as many people as possible. I just feel overwhelmed by the opportunities that this church provides for people. And we just want to make sure we take advantage of each one of them, because they are gifts truly given from you to us, or for us to provide for eternity with you. Lord, thank you for who you are. In your name we pray. Amen.
Anybody ready to sing today? Come on, sing these out.
Sing, oh, 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 oh. Sing, oh, oh. Just one word, you calm the storm that surrounds me. Just one word, the darkness has to retreat. Just one touch, I feel the presence of heaven. Just one touch, we're open to see. My heart can hear the belief.
There's nothing that our God can do. There's not a mountain that He can move. Oh, praise the name that makes the way. There's nothing that our God can do. Oh,
just one word, you heal what's broken inside me. It takes just a word. just one word, and you revive every dream. With just one touch, I feel the power of heaven. In just one touch, my eyes were open to see. My heart can heaven believe. There's nothing that I God can do. There's not a mountain that He can move. Oh, praise the name that makes the way. There's nothing that our God can do. Oh, you know there's nothing that our God can do. There's not a prison wall He can break through. Oh, praise the name that makes the way. Greater things, there's no power like the power of Jesus. Did faith arise? Did all agree? There's no power like the power of Jesus. I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Did faith arise? Did all agree? There's no power like the power of Jesus. I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like His power. There's nothing that our God can do. There's not a mountain that He can move. Praise the name makes the way. There's nothing, there's nothing that Jesus can do. You know there's nothing that our God can do. There's not a prison wall He can break through. Oh, praise the name that makes the way. There's nothing that our God can do.
Come on, let me hear you sing those out.
We're singing, whoa, whoa.
There's nothing that our God can do.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy. Amen. Thank you, band, for leading us. I feel a lot of energy in the room today. Amen. Woo. I'm ready to go. I could go for an hour. Amen. Nah, I wouldn't do that to you. But we are so glad you're here and glad you chose to worship with us this morning. Maybe you walked in as they were singing that song. I was thinking, man, not every time we walk in the doors of the church have we sensed the greatness of God throughout the week. You know, you might be walking through some things in your life or just your family life, work life, and we just don't always see the greatness of God. And so that's why we come to church, to be encouraged, to know that the greatness of God is there for us. And God wants his greatness for you in your life. And sometimes we don't sense that, and that's okay, because that's part of life, and God knows that. As we go through the Bible, and as we're even looking at Daniel today, I mean, we see struggles, we see circumstances. Sometimes we just don't see the greatness of God. We have seen the greatness of God this week, amen, across the country. We've seen God do an amazing thing with unborn kids, and we are so thankful for that. And wherever, I don't care where you stand, red or white, all that stuff, but God loves people, and he created every image. And so we are so extremely happy about that. And so we're glad you're here to worship with us. A great time to show up. We just jumped into our summer series last week. You can take out your connection card. On that attached is a message map. You can take some notes. I love it when you take notes, by the way. It just kind of encourages me that you are listening and you care what I say. But more importantly, you care what God's saying through me, and that's the most important. So we are in week two, so we're just kind of jumping into it. Last week, if you were here, if you missed it, we were reminded that God is bigger than our Babylon. Remember, we looked at Babylon and the country where Daniel was at, and we've been looking at the book of Daniel. And just thinking about our Babylon and what's that look like for us. And God is greater than that. Whatever that is in your life right now, God is greater than that. And so we're going to jump right into Daniel chapter 3. And it begins this way. King Nebuchadnezzar made an image of gold 60 cubits high and 6 cubits wide and set it up on the plain of Dura in the province of Babylon. There it is again. So King Nebuchadnezzar had made this big, good thing, all right? And the important that it is not what it looked like. The important thing is what it was really made of, all right? Got it? And also that he actually even made it at all, okay? And the reason I say that, because I want to preference Daniel chapter 2, the Babylonian king, King Nebuchadnezzar, he has this dream in chapter 2. And he has this dream and he brings in all of his astrologers, his magicians, and all these wise people to help try to figure out this dream. And they can't figure it out. And he goes into it. What do you mean? He goes into a rampage and you can't figure it out. And he actually says, oh, I'm going to kill you, all of you, because you can't figure this out. And finally, one of his wise men brings in a guy named Daniel. We know Daniel from chapter 1 in Daniel. And his Shadrach, Meshach, and his friends Abednego. And so he brings in Daniel, and Daniel helps him discover and helps him realize through God's providence and giving him the vision of what this dream really meant. And he helps him understand this dream he has, in this dream he saw a human statue, human-shaped statue made of different materials, and he was told that the different parts of the statue represented different kingdoms. And so his kingdom, King Nebuchadnezzar, was represented by the head of gold. And then there were other kingdoms that were to come after him. And part of the point of the vision was to say, hey, look, as good as your kingdom might look right now, it's going to pass away. Like all good things, it's going to pass away. There's going to be other kingdoms that come. And as powerful as all these human kingdoms are, and they might look from our eyes, eventually God is going to destroy all of them, and he's going to set up his own everlasting kingdom. And so, in other words, King, don't get full of yourself. Not something we always want to hear, right? And as great as your kingdom might look, it's really not that big of a deal in the scheme of life. And King Nebuchadnezzar seems to have missed this point that God revealed through Daniel in chapter 2. He's kind of fixated on the part of the dream, like, you know, we do that in our life. We want to fixate on the part it kind of goes with us, or we like about things that people say. And he does this. He fixated on the part of that where it says the statue is made of gold. And so now he's made a statue all made of gold. It's reinforcing his view of his greatness. And what we're really being told here is that King Nebuchadnezzar thinks as we used to, for those of you, it's hard to see everybody, but, you know, back in the 80s in the good time, amen, come on, back in the 80s, watching online, you know, give me a clap there. Back in the 80s, you might have heard this saying where he says, he's all that in a bag of chips, right? You ever wonder why did we throw in a bag of chips? I mean, Dorito chips, rough, what's the big deal there? But anybody remember that? Yeah, you do. And understand, he was thinking he was impressive in who he was. He thought he was someone special. And that's important because one of the ongoing themes throughout the book and the letter of Daniel is that God's not crazy about arrogant people. He's not crazy about them. He's not crazy about arrogance. In fact, one of the things we'll see consistently is that God actually rebukes arrogance. He rebukes it. On the other hand, God rewards what? Humility. He rewards that. So there's a principle there. One of the things we need to realize, to thrive in the world that we're walking in today in 2022, as God's people that have chosen to follow God. Again, I don't know where you're at in that. Maybe today you're still searching that out. But as God's chosen people, if you've chosen to serve Jesus, take a hold of this reality. Write it down in your notes. We thrive as God's people when we remember that God rebukes arrogance and he rewards humility. Humility. Now, this is not a truth. It's not a principle that Nebuchadnezzar really understands, okay? He doesn't understand this. He wasn't able to take notes like you are today. You see, the statue being set up is a tribute to his arrogance. It's not just building the statue that's arrogant. Check it out. Look at verse 2. I'm going to read a few scriptures here. Then he summoned the satraps, prefects, governors, advisors, treasurers, judges, magistrates, and all the other provincial officials to come to the dedication of the image he had set up. And then in verse 3, so the satraps, the prefects, the governors, advisors, treasurers, judges, magistrates, and all the other provincial officials assembled for the dedication of the image that King Nebuchadnezzar had set up. And they stood before him. Then they herald loudly, proclaim, nations and peoples of every language, this is what you are commanded to do. As soon as you hear the sound of the horn, the flute, the zither, the lyre, the harp, the pipe, and all the kinds of music, you must fall down and worship the image of gold that King Nebuchadnezzar has set up. Whoever does not fall down and worship him will immediately be thrown into a blazing furnace. Therefore, as soon as they heard the sound of the horn, the flute, the zither, the lyre, the harp, and all kinds of music, all the nations and peoples of every language fell down. They worshiped the image of gold that the king Nebuchadnezzar had set up. Now, did anybody here reading that, hearing that this morning online as well, anybody catch that there was a certain amount of repetition there? All right? There's so much repetition in the names of the government officials and the names of even the musical instruments that were written down. It's actually hard to read that passage without sounding kind of sing-songy. You know what I'm talking about? Kind of sounding almost a little bit robotic. And maybe that's the point of that passage. What Daniel is doing is he's using repetition to paint a picture of a group of people who are almost acting like robots. Almost acting like robots. Now, since robots hadn't been invented at that time, I do know that, right? Maybe it's more like what they would have thought of as puppets being played. And it's a group of people who have developed unthinking responses to certain cues. In their case, hear the bell, bow. Hear the bell, bow. You see what I'm talking about there? You hear the sound, you bow down. It's an unthinking response to a cue that Nebuchadnezzar has set up. And that's the kind of people they're dealing with, Daniel's saying we're dealing with. And I think the way he uses this repetition is intended to maybe almost make us laugh a little bit, because in some ways it's describing is something that years and years, centuries and centuries later, a psychologist named Pavlov, you know this, he would talk about later on, right? The Pavlovian response. Pavlov did a psychology study that realized if you ring a bell every time you're going to feed the dog, eventually you can take the food out of the equation and he's still going to do the same thing. It's a response. There doesn't even have to be food involved. It's unthinking, or it's just unthinking. It's a conditioned response. And what Daniel, centuries before, is doing, he's painting a picture of a whole group of people doing the same thing. Bell, bow. Bell, bow. That's what he's doing. Unthinking conditioned response. And I think the part of the reason he wants us to maybe, perhaps, laugh at them, it's not just to think of these people, the rest of these Babylonian officials, as being conditioned to respond that way, but he wants us, I think maybe he wants us to wrestle with the reality that we all of us, have a tendency to slip into that same pattern of behavior. You see, that the world gives us cues. And when the world gives us cues, we react the same way, and it's just a conditioned response that we do as people in the world that we live in. And sometimes we just sin automatically. It's a response because we sin automatically. We are here a certain thing, and our sin is a response. You probably can think back in your days, even right now maybe, we're conditioned to when this happens, we do a sin. We naturally sin. Sometimes it is not a sin. Sometimes it's just a pattern of response that honestly, they're not healthy patterns of response. And none of it is really good. Understand that. Whether it's a sin or not, none of it's good. None of these conditioned patterns of response are good. Let's try this to make sure you're staying focused here this morning. The summer solstice just happened, right? So we officially jumped into summer season. Hey, we're finally here. It's always weird because you feel like it starts like after school's over, but it doesn't officially. And so when you think of the summer, oftentimes we will say, summer means we go on, see, conditioned response right there. It's just a natural response. We think summer's here. In my house, maybe in your house, when the springtime comes, it's a natural time to change your wardrobe, right? Those are just natural responses that we do. We don't even realize it. advertising world, if you're in it, sorry, but you take advantage of this. You take a lot of advantage of this. I don't know. Maybe it's a car. Maybe it's an Apple Watch. Whatever it is, you deserve this, right? Yeah, I do deserve this. I work hard. I deserve to go get the new thing. And it's almost like, again, we're being robots to just being conditioned to respond to certain things. We have these conditioned responses. Sometimes they could be sin when we do it. Sometimes it may not be sin. Sometimes it's just kind of a thing. Somebody had a good thing happen to them. You get a promotion. Somebody in your family, your husband, wife gets a promotion. And sometimes if we're not careful, they received a blessing and our natural sin response is to, gosh, why didn't I get that? Gosh, I deserve that. I put in more time than they do. And that's our natural sin response. Here's why. There's just something ugly in us sometimes that the natural response when we see good things happen to people. You understand here this morning what I'm saying here. In a lot of different ways, the world has conditioned us to see these automatic responses. And one of the things we have to do is we have to build in us to recognize, write it down, that thriving in our world today, if we want to thrive as God's people, it requires us to identify those conditioned patterns of responses. Those conditioned pattern of responses. To find those ways that we are responding in a very natural, unthinking, we don't even think about it, we just respond. That cause us to do things like later on, after you do it, you go, I wish I didn't do that. Why did I say that to that person? I mean, they're just conditioned to responses. Sometime on social media, you might be ready to condition response somebody. We got to catch ourselves, and we got to start thinking about those things. We have to begin to identify them. Obviously, we have to break their power, too, but that requires identifying them so we understand why it's happening, okay? So I think Daniel draws us or our attention to these conditioned patterns because we recognize that we all of us struggle with similar kinds of things. What you have to understand, though, once you begin to recognize these conditioned patterns that we have, and you say, okay, I got that. I shouldn't respond. I'm going to find new ways to respond, new, healthier ways to respond to these cues in life. What you need to understand is that the world is not going to, when this happens and you do this, the world is not going to be happy with you. I mean, that's not the culture you live in. Refusing to get in line, refusing to respond to the expected ways is going to draw attention, and usually not in a good way, and that's what we're going to see here. Look at verse 8. At this time, some astrologers came forward and denounced the Jews. They said to King Nebuchadnezzar, may the king live forever. Can't you just see him? May the king live forever. Your majesty has issued a decree that everyone who hears the sound of the horn, flute, zither, lyre, harp, pipe, and all kinds of music must fall down and worship the image of God. Image of gold, excuse me. And that whoever does not fall down and worship will be thrown into a blazing furnace. Verse 12. But there are some Jews whom you have set over the affairs of the province of Babylon. And he did that in chapter 2 because Daniel revealed the vision. Daniel revealed it. So he put him, Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, he put them in high order. And so that's where they got, that's how they got to where they are. Because God initially put them there because he revealed the dream that Nebuchadnezzar had. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who pays no attention to you, your majesty. They neither serve your gods nor worship the image of gold you have set up. And you understand what's happening here, right? There's an expected response. There's a cue and there's an expected response. And these Jewish people, these Jewish guys are refusing to do the expected response. And they're starting to upset the flow of everything. And it's attracted attention because of this. And usually it's never the kind of attention we want, right? I wish they were more like them. Or we say, I wish I had their spine. That's what we hope the response would be, right? Daniel and his friends would say, I wish I had those same convictions, but it's never the same way we want. You have to make them do what everybody else is doing so they come along with the king and complain. And the way they come to the king, if you catch it, it's so brilliant the way they come to the king. Did you catch it? They came to the king and they said, there's some people over here that pay, listen to me, King, no attention to you. Now, listen, what I say earlier, he has arrogance. He loves when people pay attention to him. And so they start out, they know that. They said, there's people over here, they're not paying any attention to you. It's brilliant because he's an arrogant man. And you know the best way to get under an arrogant person's skin? Don't pay any attention to him. Don't even respond to him. Because see, those type of people can't handle that. And the reality is this, how we respond to someone who doesn't listen to us. How we respond up on the screen when people don't listen to us is like a humility dipstick. Like a humility dipstick. Now, don't think automatically you're thinking like today's world you call people dipsticks just to call them a name. All right, that's not what he's referring to here. All right, he's actually talking about the dipstick that we're talking here, that the dipstick you stick in a car. All right, and this is again, see, the way we respond to people when we don't listen to us is a pretty good indicator of how much humility we are going to have. Is going to be under the hood, right? I desperately wish that just my observation when watching other people, but the truth is, I see this same type of thing, if I'm not careful, in my own soul. You see, I've learned over the years that when I say something or I share an idea or it doesn't get paid attention to, I think many of you are like this, to the degree that I want it to be paid. It could be at your house, with your spouse, with your kids, whatever it looks like at work. But they're not paying attention to me like I want them to. My response tells me a lot about where my humility level is. You're not listening to me. It's a pretty good, could be an indicator that I need to get some more humility because I think everybody should listen to me. Right? You see, King Nebuchadnezzar doesn't get this. He doesn't understand what's going on here. There's no humility here. So we go to verse 13. So now he's furious with rage. Nebuchadnezzar summons Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. So these men were brought before the king. And Nebuchadnezzar said to them, Is it true, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you do not serve my gods or worship the image of gold that I've set up? He's asking them. Verse 15, now when you hear the sound of the horn, the flute, the zither, the lyre, the harp, the pipe, and all kinds of music, if you are ready to fall down and worship the image I made, very good. But if you do not worship it, you will be thrown immediately into the blazing furnace. Then, look at that question. Then what God will be able to rescue from my hand? Pay attention to that last part. Because you see that this arrogance. Then let's see what God does for you. Here's the cue. Here's what I expect. If you don't do what I expect, the conditioned response, you know what? You're going to die. We're going to throw you into the fiery furnace. That's arrogance. Now understand, Nebuchadnezzar has good reason to feel like, he has good reason to feel like he's stronger than their God, doesn't he? I mean, he recognizes their refusal to bow, their refusal to the conditioned response, to the cue that they've been given. He understands that because of this, the worship of God, that they believe their God is greater than him. Yahweh is greater than him. But from his perspective, he's like, that's dumb. That's stupid. He knows he's greater than their God because why? He's already defeated the nation of Israel, the army. Remember that? In chapter 1, he already defeated their army. He's like, why do you think your God, look at that, I defeated your God's nation, your God's army. He won the battle. He captured them. So from his perspective, God doesn't have his level of power that he has. Understand that. So what he's saying is, your God can't do this. From your perspective maybe, but listen, I've already beat him. But we know he knows nothing, right? He doesn't understand something. Remember last week, Daniel 1, verse 2. He won the battle. He defeated Israel. But the verse said, the Lord delivered Jehoiakim, king of Judah, in his hand. You see, we understand that he won the battle, but God allowed him to win the battle. God was bigger than him, and he doesn't see that. Excuse me. But God is the one who delivered that. We know that Nebuchadnezzar doesn't know that. Because of that, what's happening is his success is, and this happens in our world today. His success is feeding his arrogance, right? It's making him feel bigger than he really should be. Happens in our life. You get a raise, life's going good, you get this arrogance about who you are in life. And we don't remember that it's God that did it all. I mean, here at Passion, we can get, oh, man, 62 acres, 63. I go back and forth. I don't know where that 1 acre is, what it is. But, man, we can get arrogant. And if I'm not careful, even as a pastor, I can say, yeah, I bet you don't have a campus of 62, 63 acres with a 4-acre pond. But we forget that God is the one that did it all. That's what we're talking about here. That's what we're looking at. Rather than allowing success to feed our belief that we are somehow great, what we have to do is we have to grow in our humility. And we do that way. Write it down. Humility grows when we remember that our success is not a sign of our greatness. It's not a sign of our greatness. I did nothing to get us here. Our elders did nothing. God, his greatness is what did it. Humility grows when we remember that our success is not a sign of greatness. That any success we have is because God allowed it in our life. And so the success we have is only because he allowed it. Nebuchadnezzar does not understand this, so his arrogance is now starting to tower. It's brought Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego into conflict with him because they won't bow. So what he's doing, now he's giving them one last chance for them to realize, I'm the dude. You need to be worshiping me, not your Yahweh. He's expecting that conditioned response to the bell like everybody else is. And I want you to pay close attention to what they say, because I believe what they say here, what they're going to say, is in the center of this story. It's the heart of what God wants you and I to take away from this story. So pay attention online. Wake up. Just waking them up. Part of the way I know this is because it's actually in the center of the story. So it is in the center of the story. And that was a very common thing in the ancient Near East, that they would put the key to a story right in the middle of the story. And the other reason I say that is because these are the only words we hear from Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These are the only words. So I think that that's probably pretty important, besides that it's in the center. The only direct quote is right here, verse 16. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego replied to him, King Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves before you in this matter. If we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God we serve is able to deliver us from it. He will deliver us from your majesty's hand. But even if he does not, we want you to know, your majesty, that we will not serve your gods or worship the image of gold you have set up. Now, I want to push into what they're saying here. It's so important because, again, I believe it's the understanding that we need to have that's necessary to understand what it is that God wants you and I this morning to take away from this story. The other reason I want to push into it is to say that because if you are not careful, what they can say can actually maybe confuse you just a little bit. So I want to make sure you understand how they said it and what they said. I want you to get caught up. There are three parts to what they said here. The first part is this. It'll be up on the screen. God is able to deliver us from the blazing furnace, right? God is able to deliver us. He's able to. Done deal. No question about it. He's able. The second part of what they're saying is God will deliver us from your hand. God will. No question about that. He will deliver us from your hand. And then they say, but even if he does not, we will not bow down. And you might be going, getting confused by going, why would they say, wait, you don't quite believe in your God, Yahweh? You don't believe in that? Why would they put those together? And that's the way they do things here. Listen, the second and third part go together. So they said, God will deliver us. And then they think, but even if he does not, and you're like, still, why? That's confusing. Do you think for sure? Are you absolutely confident he will deliver you? Are you not sure? Which one is it? The problem is we are not actually supposed to put the second part and the third part together, all right? We are actually supposed to put the first part and the third part together, which might seem very strange but to us, but in the ancient Near East, it was called a chiasm. Now, the chiasm is where you break the first and the third up, and they actually, you break them up, but they go together. And it's very strange to us, but not to them. The important thing you need to understand, strange as it might be for us, it is so common in the ancient world. They would have naturally understood all of this. And here's what happened, though. When you put one and three together, here's the statement, all right? God is able to deliver us from the furnace, but even if he chooses not to, we will worship your gods. And what we need to understand what is happening, there are two statements of faith going on here, right? The first one is a statement of faith in God's power. God's power. God has the ability to rescue us from the furnace. He has the ability to keep us from the furnace, from even if we go in, that fire having any impact on us. He has that power. There's no question about it. We know he is able, but we don't know if that's how God's going to choose to exercise his power, do we? We don't know if that's what God's going to choose to do, but we know he has the power if he chooses. But we are not going to bow, which is really a statement of faith in God's wisdom, right? Not only his power, but his wisdom, because we know if God chooses to burn us up, he is far smarter than us, and he understands what's going on. So that must be what happens. We understand his wisdom is greater than ours. And so what they're saying is we not only trust his power, we also trust his wisdom. And you could say his timing as well. And we're going to trust his goodness. We just sing a song about it. Even if he doesn't exercise his power in the way that we see. Does that make sense? Are we getting that? He's able to rescue us from the furnace, but if he doesn't, we're going to trust him and not your gods. Now, in between these two parts, there's another statement. And it's framed in that way by the other two parts. It's the center statement. The center statement has a little bit more weight than the other two. They go together, but the center one is, again, the big one. And there's more emphasis. Look what the statement said. God will deliver us from your majesty's hand. God will deliver us. There's no uncertainty, no hesitation. Oh, I'm not sure. God will deliver us. He will deliver us from you, King Nebuchadnezzar. Remember that. No matter what you say, what you do, even if you do throw us in the fiery furnace, he will. Our God, Yahweh, can rescue us from your hand. No. Our God will rescue us, not he can. There's no question about it. And as they think about it, if you put us in there and he takes our life, that means we will be still rescued from your hand, correct? We will be in heaven forever. We will not be around you, and we won't have to go by your hand. So either way, because we know if we walk out of it, that changes everything. So either way, we will be delivered from your hand. Can you see all that? That's amazing faith. Amazing statements they made. See, killing them doesn't just demonstrate his greatness in the way that their obedience does, in the way that their submission does. So he's going to give them another chance because he understands what they understand, that even if they die in the furnace, all that we have really shown is that their power isn't as great as you might think it is. Now, this is a little bit hard for us to grasp because we are so oriented, toward comfort and good and pleasant. But here's what you have to understand. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were okay with either option, meaning they were okay with being rescued or okay with dying in the furnace. They understood, again, either way we would be delivered out of his hands. They were okay, but let's say it this way, by being miracled out of his hands, or perhaps they were okay with being murdered into heaven. Two ways to look at it. They are miracled out of his hands or they're miracled into heaven. So understand that. How much faith does it take to say that? To make those statements. It's an incredible faith statement. And so Shane, here as we kind of get closer to the end of this, how do we get to that kind of faith this morning? In 2022, how do we have faith? Because a lot of things are going on in our life. A lot of circumstances are changing, and we're not sure when to step up and follow God. How do we have this faith? Write it down. We thrive when our trust in God's greatness overshadows the fear of the furnace. We thrive, not just survive, when our trust in God's greatness overshadows our fear. Does that make sense? They had trust in God's greatness that honestly, it's completely their greatness. When they saw the furnace, they probably didn't even see the furnace. They thought, my God's bigger than that. He can do anything. And they didn't even, it overshadowed what was in front of them. How about you? What do you got this week? What do you got this month? And you're going, how are we going to get there, God? How are we doing this? But your faith. And again, he's not saying be dumb, don't do your stuff, don't do your work, whatever, all those. But have faith. Let it overshadow. You see, I don't believe for a second when they were looking at it that they didn't realize that the furnace, that was probably hot. I don't believe for a second they probably didn't feel it. And they thought, oh, that could be painful because they are humans. They are like you and I. They aren't superhumans, robots. They're regular people. But their trust in God's greatness overshadowed their fear of the furnace. And this is what God is intending us to walk out of here understanding and beginning to put into practice in our lives, is that when we trust our God's greatness, it overshadows the fear of the furnace, what's going on in your life. And then and only then can you survive, thrive, not just survive. When I'm talking about God's greatness, understand that I'm not talking about his power, because God has power. That's part of it. But power alone does not make someone great. Can we agree to that? He's a powerful man, but he's not a great man. You've said that before, right? On the screen, greatness is power coupled with character. They understand that God is able, but they also understand that God was good. And they understand that God was wise. And so they trusted the goodness and the wisdom of who God is. And that's why they could walk where they were. You couple those together. And that's what it means when we talk about the God's greatness. Understand that, too, when we talk about the furnace, I'm talking about things in this world the world uses to keep us in line. In other words, on the screen, the threats the world uses to keep us in line. That's the furnace. For Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, it was actually a furnace, right? I doubt this week you are going to have to go home and go, ooh, am I going to go into the furnace? Kind of small. Don't think we have to really think about that. But the world will continually use things as threats to us to keep us in line, to keep us following the conditioned responses, to be like the culture, right? To not be different as Christ followers, as followers of Jesus. What God is telling us is that we thrive when our trust in God, God's greatness overshadows the furnace. Whatever that looks like for you. But how do we get to that? How do we have that kind of trust, Shane? Quickly, let's go through real quickly the four ingredients. The first thing is this. In all of these, you probably know, but maybe you're not doing them. First one is this, relationship. Hear this morning. This is so important. Make sure you're paying attention online. Sit up straight. Let's go. You're slouching. It's not just about knowing God. Not just knowing God. It's being in a relationship with God. Understand that that's the essence of the Christian message. The Christian message. It's not just that God loves us, that he loves us. Oh, he's up there. He's somewhere else. He's from afar and he loves you. You know, my kids are off and I love them. God's not just saying this from afar, that we worship God. We're worshiping here at Passion. He's way up there. And no. But God loved us enough that he sent his one and only son, Jesus. He came. He took our sin upon himself. He died on a cross to pay the penalty, to get rid of the separation between an almighty God and the people he created, because sin separated us. And then he rose from the dead so he could prove he could invite us into a new life, lived in a relationship with God. That's the first key in a relationship, is to have a relationship with God, because God's greatness is experienced more profoundly in that relationship. Amen? Those that are walking? It's experience. I mean, it's one thing to look at the stars up in the sky and go, wow, man, God must be powerful. But it's a whole nother thing to have a relationship with God and be walking through years and know he is trustworthy. That's a difference between power and a relationship. So listen, if you're here today and you don't have a relationship, if you're worship, you're thinking about God. God's always at a distance. He's somewhere out there. I can never feel him. And you don't have that personal relationship. Your first step is to grow in that furnace. It's defying faith, is to get a relationship. After the service, I'll be down in this area like I usually am, and we'll be singing a song. If you want to take that first step, I'd be happy to pray with you. And you pray and mean it and let God send his Son, his Holy Spirit, into your life. And put your faith and trust, and that's the first step. The second one is this, the second ingredient we've got to move, is a furnace defying faith is prayer. We have a relationship with God, so in other words, if you have a relationship with somebody, you can talk with them. You can physically talk. You don't have to go through a priest. You don't have to go through me. God's word says you can come right to him because the Holy Spirit has been brought down. When Jesus left the earth, he left the Holy Spirit. I can't tell you from this stage, I understand all that. Oh, God, Spirit, I don't understand all that, but I trust in him because I can feel the Holy Spirit in my life and how he's led and guided me. And prayer is that conversation that we have with God. You need to be praying that because God's will not. Now understand the way he grows his trust. You trust in him. He puts you in situations. God will put you in situations where you need to trust him more. A bunch of you are like, I know, but there's got to be a catch. Because, see, we can't grow our trust in God without actually trusting him. You can't grow in your faith without actually trusting him. So he's going to provide, maybe right now, he's going to provide opportunities for you to trust him and to walk with him. Many times in my life, I could see that I've had to, okay, Jen, what are we going to do? We started this church. Okay, here we go. We're trusting you. That leads me to the third one, ingredient here is, it's that history. Write it down. It's history. This was not Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego's first experience with trusting God in a scary situation. We've already seen other experiences in the book of Daniel. They had moments when they trusted God in small ways. But in those small ways, it builds your faith. They built their trust. They grew in their trust, and it allowed them to deal with things, even things they had not yet experienced. That's why we have to take those opportunities to trust God and take those steps. And then our history of trusting him allows us to take a big step sometime in our life. When I had to look at God, you want us to start a church? What's that look like? I can't do it. Sometimes you have to take a big step of faith, but you've had the small steps all along the way. That's what the history is. And you start building. Here's the fourth thing. And finally, the act of faith, it's community. Shadrach and Meshach and Abednego, they speak as one person. They speak as one person. We don't have any breakdowns of who said what to the king. They are speaking as one voice. They're speaking as a band of brothers together. One of the things we talk a lot about at Passion is the importance of community. Small group community, being a part of a journey group. We launch them again in the fall in September. Just having that community of people you can trust. You can even start serving, and that's why serving, you start to form a community. Hospitality, they have a little community they can trust. They can send a text to one another if they have something going on. That's a part of community. It's realizing that. All of those things come together for Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, so they faced the fiery furnace, and they went, yeah. Our trust in God's greatness completely overshadows our fear. So look what happened. Let me finish this story real quick. Follow along with me. Verse 19, then Nebuchadnezzar was furious with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. By the way, that's going to happen. When you defy against it, it's going to happen. It says his attitude toward them changed. He ordered the furnace heated 7 times hotter than usual. You tell me they couldn't feel that. I mean, don't say they're supernatural. They could feel that. They understood what they were walking into. He, hotter than usual, 7 times, and he commanded some of the strongest soldiers in the army to tie them up, throw them into the blazing furnace. Verse 21, so these men wearing their robes, trousers, turbans, and other clothes were bound and thrown into the blazing furnace. The king's command was so urgent, and the furnace was so hot that the flames of the fire killed the soldiers who took up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and these 3 men, firmly tied, fell into the blazing furnace. 24, the king Nebuchadnezzar leaped to his feet in amazement and asked his advisors, can you just see him looking at, weren't there 3 men that were tied up and thrown in the fire? They replied, certainly, your majesty, yes. He said, look, I see 4 men walking around, unbound, unharmed. And the fourth looks like it's the son of gods. Nebuchadnezzar then approached the opening of the blazing furnace and shouted, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, servants of the Most High God, come out, come here. So they come out of the fire, and the satraps, prefects, governors, and royal advisors all around them, all these people, they saw that the fire had not harmed their bodies, nor was a hair on their head singed. There was a joke there, but I won't say it. But somehow, their robes were not scorched, and there was no smell of fire on them. Then Nebuchadnezzar said, praise be to God. Did you see what just happened in verse 28? He said, praise be to God. He's saying, praise be to Yahweh. For these men who has sent his angel and he rescued his servants, they trusted in him and defiled the king's command and were willing to give up their lives rather than serve or worship any god except their own. Verse 25, therefore I decree, Nebuchadnezzar, arrogant Nebuchadnezzar, king, man of all, I decree that people of any nation or language who say anything against the God Yahweh of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego be cut into pieces. Now that's a little graphic, but... and their houses be turned into piles of rubber, for no other god can save in this way. Then the king promoted these men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, in the province. I would love to tell you that if you trust God's greatness, nobody's ever going to touch you. Nothing's ever going to touch you. I would love to be able to tell you that as your pastor and say, you trust in it, nothing's going to happen to you. That's not the case. Sometimes God exercises his power in this way, and sometimes he doesn't. God has good reasons. I believe sometimes we might know the reasons. I believe we may die and not even ever know the reasons why he didn't do what he didn't do. The reality is, I can promise you, you will, hear this, you will always escape the furnace. You will always. The reality is, write it down in your notes, this story is not a blueprint for how to escape the furnace. This story is a blueprint how to face it. God, how do I get away from my circumstances? How do I keep from this happening in my life? No, how to face it and walk through it with a God that has the power and the wisdom to know what you're going through and walking through. What does it matter, Shane? Who cares how we face the furnace? How we face the threats the world uses to keep us in line? Listen to me. How we face the furnace matters more than your image. Matters more than you can even think as well, because we have a trust in God's greatness that overshadows our fear of the furnace. We have the furnace in a way, we face the furnace in a way that calls attention. What did it call attention to? What did he say right away? Holy cow, your God is amazing. He didn't say those words, but when this happens in our life, it calls attention to God's greatness. That's what he wants. Happens when we put God's greatness on display. In modern terms, let me say it like this, write it down. When our trust in God's greatness overshadows our fear of the furnace, we understand this last part coming off the pandemic, don't we? God's greatness goes viral. His greatness goes viral. And we see churches and communities just explode, and you go, man, how did God just do? Because it went viral. Because people started living it out in their life, and they started realizing, even through circumstances, through death, through job loss, whatever it may be, I'm going to realize God is greater than any of it. He has wisdom that I don't understand, and I'm going to realize today that he is far greater, and I guarantee he will deliver you. Shane, how can you do it? Because he does it over and over and over. He's done it over and over in my life. Shane, are there times you get down? Times Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, I believe, walked in and we're going, oh, you know, maybe. Man, he can deliver us. God's greatness goes viral. It sets this, when it does, it sets the stage for remarkable things. Amen? It sets the stage. Sometimes God will change circumstances in your life. He will do that. And when he does, that's awesome, isn't it? It's awesome. Sometimes God uses the way we face the furnace to encourage other people. Several years ago, I've said it before here, when Stephen Curtis Chapman, Christian artist, one of my favorite, son backed up over his child and killed her. The way he faced it and walked through it, and I saw it in others, it encouraged me of who God is. That's what happens as we do that. Sometimes shot in the spine to not back away from the furnace. And I think it's interesting, Nebuchadnezzar, isn't it a pretty big shift in his mind of all of a sudden the God that he wants to worship? That's huge. Now don't make the mistake of thinking that Nebuchadnezzar became a Christian. Don't make the mistake, oh, he became a Christ follower right away. No, he just began to recognize who God is. You notice this by his response. Because he says, anybody who talks smack about their God, kill them. That's not really the Christian response. He's not all the way there, but something is happening in his heart now. See, that's because God's greatness has gone viral. And when his greatness goes viral, watch out. So, real quickly, final three questions here with you, and we're going to sing our final song. What's your furnace right now? Remember last week we said Babylon is the scary thing you may be facing in life coming up. Well, what's the threat that the world is using to keep you alive? You might be able to think of something immediately, or maybe you don't. I would argue that we probably have something, but we're just so conditioned to respond we don't even realize it sometimes. Whether you're in facing a furnace now, or maybe you know one prophecy is coming, because it probably is. Leads to a second one. What concrete step will you take this week to grow your trust in God's greatness? What will that be? Think is to help you grow in God's greatness. Question for myself as I go through this week: what is the step, Shane, that you're going to take to continue to trust in God's greatness? We just talked about four ingredients, didn't we? Relationships, praying, history, community. Maybe one of those four. What areas you're going to step out? Maybe it's a relationship with somebody else. You need to grow in that. Help encourage them. Maybe it's just getting on your knees, praying once a day. Not out of, God, I need this, I need this, I need this. What's your concrete step? And finally, what are some conditioned patterns of response that you are struggling with? Identify. What are you? Would you stand? Side, you take that first step of faith. Pray together. Allow God to come into your life and change you from the inside out. Pray with me. Father God, thank you again for all that you've done. God, I thank you for this story that I really have heard since I was 4 or 5 years old. I can confess to you, God, even through this week as I was going through this story again in my life. Sometimes we can just read it and say, oh yeah, God is so good, he saved me. Man, what a failure. As I read this week and I just thought about it, God, I confess to my church here, I don't know if I would have to. I hope I would. God, you want us to be confident. Father, I pray in my life, I pray for people here, Passion, watching online, God, I pray that they would sense through your spirit, God, that we can walk in that same faith that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego have. Whatever furnace is right in front of us coming up this week, next month, next year, God, whatever that looks like, God, you're bigger than it. Father, I don't know, someone you might voice right here may need to turn their life over to you, and they're still doubting and asking questions. I pray, God, you would just meet them right where they're at. No matter what their past is like, no matter what they've walked through, I pray that you would meet them right where they are. God, you did that when I was 7 years old. I may not have had a huge past, but I was a sinner. You knew that. I realized Jesus, your son, was the only answer. Peace, hope, joy. God, today we want to thrive. We don't just want to survive. We want to thrive. I pray that you would work on hearts this morning. Move us, help us this week to be more like you. It's in Jesus' name. We're going to sing this one last song. And I asked Brandon to sing it several weeks ago. It's kind of a little bit of an oldie, but not necessarily maybe a sing-along song, worship song, but I think the words are so powerful, goes right with what we're talking about. It's called Thrive. So if you don't know it, don't worry about singing it. Just listen to the words. Thrive.
Dream has died, like a tree planted by the water, we never will run dry. So live in
water flowing through, God breathe us for more of you. Fill our hearts and fill our souls with one desire. Just to know you and to make it known, let your name on high shine like the sun, make up this running high. We know we were made for so much more than ordinary life. It's time for us to
into your word we're digging deep to know our Father's heart. Into the world we're reaching out to show them who you are.
So baby, water flowing through, God we thirst for more of you. Fill our hearts and fill our souls with one desire.
Just to know you and to make you know.